Welcome to the Treasury of Solomon, where we go verse by verse through the book of Proverbs to find the wisdom that God has for us. Today's verse is Proverbs 2 and 8. It says, "He keepeth the paths of judgment and preserveth the way of his saints." This verse is building on what we found in the second half of the last verse. "He is a buckler to them that walk uprightly." This verse is continuing to tell to us and explain to us how he protects us. Like any good parent, he makes the protection of his children his top priority. Let's first look at the first half of the verse. "He keepeth the paths of judgment." Judgment is basically our faculty and ability of using our discernment to make decisions, irrespective of whether they're good or bad. It's simply just a mechanism to do so. The real thing that stands out is the word path. In the Hebrew, it means manner, highway, and it even means fortune. That's an important definition. A highway implies that we're traveling, that there's motion, that we're heading towards something or somewhere. And the reality is that that's true. We are heading somewhere. Our life is a journey, and so are our decisions. Those are the fuel that propel us in a certain direction. Good decisions propel us further down the road that we want to be on, and the bad ones may take us on an untimely and unplanned detour. Maybe they delay us a little bit. Maybe they make us go out of our way a little bit. That didn't have to be the case. We didn't have to unnecessarily make our journey harder and more difficult. But sometimes decisions are difficult. Sometimes we have a lapse in good judgment. And sometimes we're fooled by the enemy or by the world to make a decision that seems great in the moment, but really isn't in our best interest or in the will of God for our life. The other part of the definition, fortune, that's important too. God isn't only trying to protect us on our journey of decision-making and journey of life, keeping us on the right road to move towards his will and keeping us in line through the guardrails of the Holy Spirit within us. He also is very much involved in protecting and guarding our fortune, our future, our potential. We don't have to go to a fortune teller, and we shouldn't. No Christian has any business being involved with them or partaking of their services. We have a God who tells us our fortune. We find it in his word. We find it when we commune with him and speak with him, and he guards it, giving us what we need to know in the moment, giving us the wisdom and the strength to act on his inward impulses to accomplish the tasks that he called us to do. Sometimes it feels like our future is so fragile, like it's hanging by a thread, and we're not sure if we'll actually see the future that we're hoping to see. But we need to entrust it to God, knowing that he promises and that he desires to protect it from all the attacks of the enemy and all the lies of the world that try to take it from us. The enemy has no future, which is why he's so desperate to steal and destroy yours. The last word that we need to look at in this half of the verse is keepeth. Other versions say guard or watch over. In the Hebrew, the meanings go much deeper than that, though. It means besieged, hidden, observe, preserve. We're continually being besieged by the enemy. That's part of his age-old playbook that he's been using in his spiritual warfare against God's people. He wants us to be so overwhelmed by his siege that we become downtrodden and feel defeated, which makes us put up less and less of a resistance, and then his victory comes more and more easily for him. We obviously can't let that be our reality, and it won't be when we entrust ourselves to God for his protection. He knows we're besieged, which is why he promises to be our protector, to be our preserver. We will have to go through the attacks, we will have to go through the battles, that's inevitable, but through it all, we will be preserved, and we'll come out the better, the stronger, and the wiser for having gone through those battles. He hides us away in the secret place of the Most High, as we abide under the shadow of the Almighty. He hides us from danger and from destruction. He wants to see us safe. He wants to see us secure in his loving arms, if only we'll look to him for our protection instead of looking to ourselves. He protects us as we make our decisions, sending his Holy Spirit to lead and guide us into all truth. As we submit to and observe his sayings, it will go well with us. We're promised that. We'll be preserved as we move closer and closer towards his will for our life. It's when we don't listen that things go off course. It's our job to observe, and it's his job to preserve. The second half of the verse said, "and preserveth the way of his saints." Preserveth is the first word here that we need to look at. It's very similar to keepeth. In the Hebrew, it means to keep, to guard, to be circumspect, to take heed to self, to look narrowly, to observe, to hedge about as with thorns, to protect and to attend to. There's clearly some overlap here, but we also get deeper insight into this type and level of protection that God is promising to us. He promises to hedge us about, which shouldn't sound all that strange to us. Job 1 and 10, which is recounting the devil speaking concerning Job, says, "Hast not thou made a hedge about him and about his house and about all that he hath on every side? Thou wast blessed the work of his hands, and his substance is increased in the land." Psalm 34 and 7 says, "The angel of the Lord encampeth round about them that fear him and delivereth them." The Lord is circumspect. He covers all angles. He covers all sides of the equation, each aspect of the problem, every type of possibility. He has it all perfectly under control. He looks to the self, your life, and he keeps it under his loving, watchful eye. He looks narrowly, meaning that he looks carefully. He turns over every stone. He looks closely, examining what needs to be examined so that he can perfectly protect you. He's your heavenly security detail, and he watches over you to thwart and prevent the attacks of the enemy. The next word that stands out is the word way, which is very similar to the word path that we were looking at earlier. And this one also has some overlap. In the Hebrew, it means road, distance, journey, manner. What this tells us is that he goes the distance with you. He takes you by the hand on the narrow road of life, the road that not many travel in this world, and he guides you all the way until you get to your destination, which is an eternity spent with him. He never leaves or forsakes you. He's with you on the journey all the way. He goes along with you for the ride of life. Every part of your life, every aspect of it, every minute of it, every decision, every thought, every word, every action, they're all in his hands. He preserves it all with a hedge of protection, which Satan can't break through. The last thing that we need to look at is the phrase his saints. In the Hebrew, this phrase means the godly ones, kind, pious, godly man, holy one, merciful. The Modern Amplified says after saints, the word believers, and the New International Version calls us his faithful ones. So how do you know if you qualify for this promise? How do you know if it belongs to you? Are you a believer? Are you faithful to God and to his word? Are you godly, kind, merciful? Are you trying to be what God is calling you to be? If you've invited him into your heart to be your personal Lord and Savior, if you're making a real effort to follow God and his word, if you're putting forth a real effort to make him the center of your life, then this promise is absolutely for you. It belongs to you. It's the inheritance that Jesus died to give you. He wants to protect you when you make decisions in your life. He wants to guide you on the journey of life, but you need to let him. He wants your life to be the best that it could possibly be, a life that honors and glorifies him as his greatness is reflected in and through your life. So take his hand today, give him control, and let him influence your life in every last area, and you'll be amazed at the results. Let's close in prayer. Lord, today we thank you that you're not some far-off God who doesn't care about his people, doesn't watch over his creation, but that you're a personal God who requires personal faith from his people. Lord, today we put our faith in you. We put our trust in you. We put our future and our entire life in your hands. Lord, we thank you that you sent your Holy Spirit to lead and guide us into all truth, to help us when we make decisions, and to watch over us on this road of life, this narrow road that you've sent us on. Lord, we thank you for your constant protection and preservation, and Lord, we give you all the honor, all the glory, and all the praise. In Jesus' name, amen. Remember before you leave to hit the subscribe button, hit the notification bell, and remember to like and comment below. The wisest thing we can ever do is give our lives to Christ and be born again. If you want to have Jesus as a part of your life today, all you need to do is invite him into your heart to be your personal Lord and Savior. Trust him that you've been forgiven and choose to live for him who died for you. We'll see you next time as we continue to explore the Treasury of Solomon and study the King's Word together.